Good morning and a warm welcome to the 13th meeting of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee. This morning we have received apologies from Donald Cameron. Our first agenda item is a continuation of our inquiry into the Scottish Government's international work, and today we'll have our second panel on this topic, and we're joined at committee this morning from Anthony Salomon, Managing Director of European Merchants, and Dr. Fabian Zulig, Chief Executive and Chief Economist of the European Policy Centre. And can I welcome you both to the meeting? Can I also thank Mr. Salomon for his submission before today's meeting? And we're going to move straight to questions if possible, and I've got a couple of opening questions. Dr. Zulig, in your briefing for the previous session's Europe Committee legacy paper, you stated that the representation of Scottish interests in the EU will be crucial for business, but also at policy level. But paradoxically, leaving the European Union will require a higher degree of investment into these relationships, as Scotland has lost the automatic right to be at the table, which it previously enjoyed via the UK as a member state. So I'd be interested in hearing your views about how open the EU will be to engaging directly with the Scottish Government, and what are the main challenges you see representing Scottish interests in the EU? I'll go to Dr. Zulig, thanks.
Thank you very much for inviting me today. Yes, I think there is a challenge. It is more difficult for a third country, a country outside the European Union, to engage with European policy processes. That's probably even more difficult as a part of a third country. So there has to be a consideration also what is in it for the member states, for the institutions with which Scotland wants to engage. I do think that in general terms, the doors are open. I do think that institutions, member states, regions are very happy to also engage with others. And we have seen that over the years with other third countries, with other actors in the system. But it does require that additional engagement, that additional investment. And it does require, in my view, also a focus in terms of what Scotland might want to be engaged in, because to cover the whole breadth of topics, to be engaged in everything, I think is very difficult.
Thank you. And Mr. Salomon, in your submission, you state that Scotland lacks a sufficient policy culture in Europe and international relations. I wonder if you could expand on that just a little and suggest how we might develop that policy and deliver it.
Yes, of course, and good morning, convener. So I think there are two main aspects that I would mention of the Scottish Government developing a strategy. What Fabian has just said, that you want to engage in the European Union and to have a degree of taking account of the challenges which Scotland faces engaging as a part of a third country and not being a state, and also having a difficult relationship with the UK government. That is a factor as well. But you need to have a well-developed strategy that outlines a post-Brexit vision for what the Scottish government aims to achieve from engagement with the European Union and how it intends to go about doing that, considering the new challenges that need to be faced. Secondly, in terms of a policy culture, I mean to say that I think it would be useful to have a greater degree of what I would say is Europeanization of Scottish governance. And you know, it's not a question of engagement. Engagement already exists, but that Scottish politics collectively, and this is the Scottish government, but in the Scottish institutions generally, are sort of deepen their degree of interconnection as to what is happening in Brussels and what is happening in member state capitals and elsewhere. I don't think we see that as much, and that makes it a little bit more difficult for the Scottish government to have that kind of strategic approach, because if we look at existing Scottish government documentation, you know, there's a degree of optimism, which is, you know, normal for a government, but I think there's sometimes over-optimism of how much influence and how much success the Scottish government is going to be able to have in the years ahead.
Thank you. I'm going to move to questions from the committee, and I'll go to Mr. Ruskell, please.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Good morning to you both. Can I ask you about where we are at the moment within the sort of EU institutional cycle and how third countries, but also countries that are sub-states, that are part of third countries, are engaging with that institutional cycle process at the moment? What are the sort of strategic areas? How are they engaging with that? Could we start, Mr. Salamone, please?
Yes, of course. Thank you, Mr. Ruskell. I think it is always useful to ensure that your engagement with the European Union matches what the EU is talking about. Of course, the EU is not a monolithic entity, but speaking of Brussels and the EU institutions, of course, it is essential to interconnect, if you like, with the priorities of the EU institutions. The Scottish Government did that in a fashion with its strategic agenda document that was published on the day of Brexit. But yes, I think that's crucial. But at the same time, I still think that the more important point is that you or the Scottish Government in this case has its own priorities. And the question is trying to connect them. You know, you don't want to be chasing the EU agenda constantly as it changes, or chasing each presidency as it changes and say, what are the priorities of this presidency and how do we connect with them? You need to have your own core strategic priorities of these are, whatever they are, the 3, 4, 5 main things that we want to do with them. And we're going to try to link those to, because that links with what we want to see in terms of our EU engagement, the kind of successes that we want, and where possible, though it's limited, where we can shape EU policy in a particular way. So yes, useful to shadow what's happening in the EU and engage with it, but on the basis of your own clearly articulated priorities.
Yeah. So are there examples of third countries or sub-states that have been particularly successful then in aligning their strategic priorities with that institutional cycle? Do you have an example of that?
Well, as you may know, I wrote a report for the previous committee looking at how certain regions and countries engage with the EU, and there are a number of good examples, I suppose. The Basque country comes to mind as a region which clearly is part of an EU member state and is involved in that sense, but with is well known in Brussels for its successes in Industry 4.0, in vocational training, in advanced manufacturing, through its smart specialization strategy. It is known for that. People in the EU institutions may often listen to what they have to say on those issues. And it's an area where they have developed a I wouldn't say niche expertise, but certainly a profile for themselves in Brussels, and that they focus on that. And I would say that they are successful.
Okay. Can I bring in Dr. Zulik, please?
I'm unmuted now. Very happy to go into it. I think the first thing I would emphasize is that the European Union is changing rather rapidly. This is something which is hard to keep up with, even within the Union. So even for member states and for subnational entities within those member states, sometimes the pace of change sometimes takes them at a surprise. I think this is to do with the big challenges which not only Europe faces, but certainly the discussions we're having around climate change, around the technology transition, around COVID, pandemics, health, and the impact that has on economies, on societies, inequalities, geopolitics, future of Europe. I mean, all of this is on the agenda at the moment. So I would go back to the comment I made earlier. It's very much a question of focus. So as an example of a country which has been rather successful in the area of engagement it has chosen, I would mention, for example, Norway, where we've seen that when it comes to single market issues, Norway has engaged very effectively with the European system. And that's not just the Norwegian government. That is also at the regional level, at the city level. Before COVID, I was always half joking that I see more regions from Norway than I see from any other country. That shows a bit the engagement which was there. So there are examples of that, but I think the Norwegian example also shows that that is selective, because even with having a selective approach, it requires an enormous effort. So the Norwegian representation in Brussels is very sizable. It's much more sizable than some of the smaller member states, because there's a real investment from Norway into the European Union. Norway engages very much, for example, on energy, because clearly there's a clear interest from the Norwegians. So I think it's looking at these specific examples, and there are other ones which we could mention, but I think what they all have in common is that they have that focus, they decide what area they need to be engaged in most, and then they do the significant investment which is needed to do that.
Yeah, thanks. That's all very useful. Can I ask then, just following on from that, is that focus then carry through to the concordats that are established between these countries and sub-state regions and countries and the EU? What are the most successful features of those concordats? Perhaps if I could go back to Mr. Salamone.
Also, it's useful to remember that, as you will know, each state has its own constitutional arrangements for how sub-state entities engage. And most of them are more codified, I would say, than the approach that's taken in the UK. So, what works best is, when the central government and the sub-state government can work well together. Fabian mentioned Norway and the extent to which the sort of Norwegian mission to the EU and the Norwegian regions in the EU, that they collaborate together, they work together in a way that which multiplies the effect which they have. So that kind of, not just cooperation, but genuine collaboration and indeed perhaps partnership is useful. And oftentimes that can be more useful than the formal structures. And then, of course, dealing with some of the challenges of the formalities. So, for instance, the different autonomous regions of Spain, they sort of rotate in which one is more sort of relates more and attends sort of council meetings on behalf of all of the regions, which on the one hand is useful and that gives them some role. On the other hand, it's a challenge because that they cycle through that, I believe, every 6 months or so. So each region has to sort of get back into the business of doing that and sharing it. And of course, trying to in a sense, represent every region while trying to articulate their own interests. So there are different mechanisms that countries inside and outside the EU have developed. But I think the core point is, regardless of whatever legal structures exist, is that there is a positive spirit of collaboration between the central state and the sub-state.
And does that sort of ethos of collaboration, does that extend to parliaments and civic society? Is that codified in these concordats as well? Is there an expectation that citizens will be involved in discussions around trade agreements or any other policies that are being pursued by regions or states?
It doesn't immediately come to my mind of an example where it's legally codified that you would have that degree of civil society engagement when the legal document, if you like, is between the central state and the sub-state as to how they will engage in the EU. But of course, there's certainly a growing desire to involve citizens in policymaking. I think that's very appropriate if you want to sustain public support, be it for EU membership or, I suppose, in our case, for a closer or a positive relationship with the European Union that involves engaging with citizens. I think that there's a recognition of that. And I perhaps that may be a feature to come in terms of the intergovernmental relations. But at the moment, I'd say that if the central state wants to engage citizens or if a region wants to engage citizens, they mostly just do that on their own.
Okay, Dr. Zulik.
Yeah, I think Anthony has already mentioned a number of the features. I think there's a difference between formal arrangement and the informal arrangement. I think that there very often is discussion which involves not so much citizens directly, but certainly representative groups who are engaged in particular areas. And that when it comes to, for example, certain areas of cooperation. If you look at, for example, environment, then very often you will have NGOs involved in those arrangements. But I think in the end, the European Union is also a political body. The component parts of the European Union are political. And the challenge for third countries or for sub-state actors in third countries is, to put it very bluntly, what is it they bring to the party? Why should the other side be interested in that cooperation, in investing in that relationship? If you are talking about a member state or even sub-state actor in a member state, the logic is much clearer of why you're engaging, because these are the actors you will have to cooperate with on an ongoing basis. Really, the demand is always from the third country and say, what is it you can bring to this? How do you contribute to the objectives of the European Union? And on that basis, you can then have a fruitful exchange.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener, and thank you for joining us this morning. Kind of following on from what Dr. Zulig has just been talking about you know, what countries can bring to the table, third countries can bring to the table, I'm interested to know your thoughts on how Scotland is perceived within Europe and within the EU. Mr. Salmon, maybe you could start.
I think that the Scottish Government and indeed wider actors in Scotland have been very successful in articulating that many people in Scotland did not wish to see Brexit happen or the manner which it happened. And you know that's very clear. That message is across. Anyone who wants to know that Scotland did not go for Brexit and that most people or a majority of people in Scotland were perhaps unhappy with the relationship that has been arrived at between the EU and the UK know that. That is clear. So the question is what is the Scottish Government and indeed wider actors in Scotland, what are they going to pursue in terms of engagement? You know, we talked about strategic priorities, but in terms of what sort of form that takes, I have for a two-pillar approach of practical cooperation with actors on areas of mutual interest. And Fabio was just talking about the importance of mutuality. You know, it's not just about talking about things that are important to us, to Scotland, it's about what's important to EU actors and where can you find that common ground that opens the possibilities for substantive engagement. And then, of course, the second is strategic contributions on debates on the future of Europe. You know, as far as I am aware, the Scottish Government has not sought to participate or contribute even externally to the Conference on the Future of Europe. And I think that is, you know, something that it could have tried to do. I appreciate there are challenges not being part of the EU, but we are still part of Europe. So I imagine that there is a, you know, there can be a positive perception of Scotland, sure. And of course, you know, that sort of pro-EU element can enhance that. But that sentimentality only goes so far if it's not, you know, activated, if you like, and connected to what you mentioned of what matters to EU actors and what why is it useful for them. That sort of sentimentality only goes so far.
Okay, thank you for that. Just with regards to the Conference of Europe, the future of Europe, I think there is Scottish participation in that. But I'd be interested to know your thoughts on Global Scots and the Friends of Scotland group, and also if there is specific things that Scotland as part of a third country, can actually bring specifically to the European table.
Sure. So on the Conference of the Future of Europe, yes, I know that the people in Scotland are going to engage, and I think that's wonderful. It's important to say that, you know, regardless of constitutional matters or relationship formally with the EU, that, you know, there are important issues at stake in Europe, and everyone in different parts of Europe has a view. I think that's important. In terms of these kinds of groups which you mentioned, yes, it's so the Friends of Scotland group in the European Parliament. Yes, that is a very important established. Bringing together parliamentarians from different political parties who have affinity for Scotland, I would say that you know that is a private forum. I suppose that's obvious, but I do find it a little bit unusual the way in which the Scottish Government sort of publicly sort of promotes it, if you like. I mean, I know it's on the Scottish Government website, an example of engagement. That's a private thing that needs to sort of be private. I mean, obviously you could mention that it exists, but the more you sort of shine a light on it, the less likely you are to have the kind of substantive engagement you might want from it. In terms of Global Scots, so engaging with people who are part of our global diaspora, and that includes anyone who has an affinity for Scotland, I think that there is probably more that the Scottish government could do on that, including through its representative offices, engaging with the local communities of Scots who are there, or people who are have an affinity with Scotland, and integrating that more in a coherent way in the engagement. I think that's something that can be done to a greater extent than it is.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Salmoni. And similar questions to Dr. Zulig.
I fully agree that Scotland is generally perceived positively. On a European level, there is the perception that Scotland shares some of the values. And I think COP26, Glasgow, has also reinforced that. So in that sense, I think particularly on these issues of mutual interest, where I would put climate change as one of the key areas, there is a positive perception. But I would also put a bit of a reality check on that, in the sense that Scotland is no longer part of the European Union. And the relationship between Scotland and the EU will not exclusively go through the Trade and Cooperation Agreement, but the overall relationship of the UK with the European Union will have a significant, if not decisive, impact on the relationship Scotland can have with the European Union. And when it comes to, if you like, formal engagement, official engagement, much of that will be done within the framework of the TCA and the bodies which have been set up within that. So that is a limitation, especially since the overall relationship is at this moment in time not going well, and that has an impact on cooperation across a wide range of different areas where there could be more potential to work together, but at the moment, there doesn't seem to be the wish of the British government to do that, and that is limiting the amount of opportunity which is there. I think in terms of these kind of mechanisms, which you've mentioned, Global Scott, other mechanisms, my general response to that would be the more the better. I think these kind of ways of engaging with the outside world have a very positive long-run return in terms of value for money. I think they tend to be a very high value for money, even though it's very difficult to measure. But having goodwill, being connected, being also able to draw on people's expertise, on information, I think is very valuable. And I would say, referring a bit back to the previous question, if you want to know who's successful, it is those countries, those regions, those actors which have recognized this and who are willing to also then invest in it because they can see the long-term benefit for them.
Thank you. Yeah, in earlier sessions, we've taken evidence from third sector organizations that have talked about the benefit to them being integrated and kind of feeding off information from counterparts in Europe, and they would hope to be able to continue that. So thank you for that.
Thank you. Mr. Golden.
Thank you, convener. And I'd really like to follow up from Jenny Minto's points there and ask around engagement and the Scottish Government approach, and perhaps start with Mr. Salomon. Mr. Salomon, in your submission, you state that the strategy should minimise Scottish constitutional affairs and promote purposeful separation of European and international relations from the independence debate. What strategy, in your opinion, is the Scottish Government pursuing?
A a strategy. I think it would be useful for the Scottish Government to articulate one, a post-Brexit one. Of course, we have documentation. We have an international framework, which is about 2 pages long. There's a promise of a global affairs framework, which I very much hope will articulate that kind of vision. But it's very clear if you look at Scottish Government documentation, and particularly at the political level, that there are internal Scottish constitutional debate features in engagement. I'm not talking about the technical level, but I'm talking mostly at the political level. And it's very clear that the Scottish Government has a position on independence. Talks about that in its European international engagement. It's not the core aim of that engagement, but it features from time to time. And I do not think that that is useful. Who wants to know knows that there is a constitutional debate in Scotland and knows that there is a question of independence or remaining in the UK. And you know, that is something, in my view, which is best left to civil society when it comes to engaging with European international actors. Because the risk is that if you talk about these constitutional issues, that you reduce the scope for substantive cooperation with EU international partners, because you know, obviously they don't want to be involved in Scotland's or the UK's internal affairs. So in my view, it's something to be minimized as much as possible and to focus on the areas of practical cooperation. As I say, the Scottish Government does that, but perhaps it could do that more.
Thanks for that. And just as a follow-up, what do you think Scottish Parliament's role should be in scrutinising Scottish Government engagement priorities?
I think the Parliament has a crucial role. I think it's important to recognise that the Scottish Government, you know, as stated in the programme for government, intends to increase its engagement in the European and international plane, if you like. And to me, it would make perfect sense for the Scottish Government to increase its scrutiny of what the Scottish Government is, of Scottish Parliament, to increase its scrutiny of what the Scottish Government is doing in that area, so that you can, that scrutiny could focus on the global affairs framework, as in what the substantive content of that will be, what kind of priorities and areas of focus and strategic objectives which the Scottish Government will articulate, and of course, how it is going about doing so. And more generally speaking, you know, of course, there's been a lot of emphasis on Brexit and the formal arrangements under the trade and cooperation agreement between the EU and the UK in terms of the attention of the Scottish Parliament. And that is very natural, given that is so consequential to our engagement or our relationship with the EU now. But I think it's also worthwhile to continue to and perhaps develop more scrutiny of the substance of what the Scottish Government is actually doing in terms of its engagement with the EU.
Thank you, Mr. Salomon. Now, Dr. Zuleg, if just reflecting on Mr. Salomon's comments, I wonder if you could comment on the general engagement approach from the Scottish Government and the role of the Scottish Parliament in that.
Yes, I think I will try to answer that a bit more generally rather than looking specifically at the Scottish situation. I think the first thing I would emphasize is that where this kind of engagement is successful, it is very much, and Anthony already alluded to that, about a team approach of actually acting together. So in this particular case, I would say that yes, there's an important role for the Scottish Government, but it should also bring on board a Team Scotland approach, bringing together all of the different actors which have a role in that relationship. And there I would certainly see the Parliament also to have a role, not only in the sense of scrutiny, which is important, but also in the sense of direct engagement, of being involved in these processes. One of the very common features of my work in Brussels is that I often receive delegations from parliaments, both at the member state level, but also third countries. I was recently talking, for example, to the House of Commons committee. So I think these kind of exchanges are very important, and they should go beyond just simply the government itself. I think on a broader level, where that is possible, that should also be extended to cooperation with London, with the UK level, but also with other actors within the UK. I think it makes sense that, for example, the devolved administrations work together on some of these issues. So it is a multifaceted approach, and certainly Parliament should also play a role in that.
Thank you, Dr. Zuleg. Thank you, Convener.
Ms. Boyack.
Thanks very much, Convener. It's been very interesting listening to your answers from my colleagues so far. Can I ask a question about the priorities for how we make the connections, both in terms of Scottish Government, in terms of our scrutiny of the Government, but also in terms of parliamentary work to follow up the questions? Particularly want to ask a question about Mr. Salamone, you've mentioned in your report a couple of recommendations I want to follow up in detail. Firstly, you make a suggestion about better delineating the operation of Scottish offices within diplomatic missions, within the UK diplomatic missions. So I was wondering if you could tell us a bit more what that would look like in practice. And associated to that, you've also talked about the range of offices that the Scottish Government has, again, how they could be better used, and what you think the priority should be for expansion in the EU. I think you'd made some, you said the existing offices were logical, but there was something about needing more of a rationale for the best options for expansion in the EU area. So could you focus on those two issues?
Of course. Thank you, Ms. Boyack. Yes, thank you, Ms. Boyack. So on the question of the Scottish Government's representative offices and how they, most of them are situated within UK diplomatic missions, so within UK embassies, and my suggestion was that there could be a new Concordat on international relations, because there was an EU Concordat that is now obsolete, UK's withdrawal from the European Union, and we have an international relations Concordat that dates to 2013. As the proposal is to leave that as it is, but I think there could be merit in seeing if there were a possibility of renewing that, and as part of that renewal. To sort of reflect a bit more of how things work at the moment, if you like, and see that in the Concordat, which is to say, the Scottish Government offices, they pursue their own agenda, even though they're based in UK missions, and that's perfectly logical. And of course, they communicate to each other and talk to each other, and that's good. But I have seen examples, for instance, where the Scottish Government is aiming to hold an event. And it was going to be in the UK embassy, but then it was sort of discovered that the topic might be one that the UK government didn't like, and so then they moved the event to another location. And that sort of thing, to me, is something that perhaps could be avoided if there was a renewed sense through the Concordat. In terms of the offices themselves, yes, I mean, they do plenty of good work. So it's not necessarily a question of the sort of performances of the offices, if you like. For me, it would be seeing that they work as a coherent network. Of course, that's a process of development because some of these offices are new. They will take time to develop in their own right. But that there's a degree of connectivity. And of course, that links back to Edinburgh. Everything is about what happens in Edinburgh and the home sort of headquarters, if you like, to ensure that while these individual offices have the necessary flexibility to adjust to their local circumstances, they do different things. Brussels, it's more on EU policymaking. In Berlin, be more about German politics and trade and investment and so on. But that there is sufficient interconnection between these offices, and that they are all working collectively in the service of a clearly articulated Scottish Government strategy for engagement. In respect of the expansion of offices, it is reasonable for these offices to this network to grow in relation to Scotland's current constitutional position. But I think given that all of these representative offices, it's worth having a suitable rationale and justification for them. Why the Scottish Government feels it needs new offices, why it has chosen particular locations that it has chosen, why those locations will be in the service of whatever strategic objectives it has already outlined in its clearly articulated strategy. And then on that basis, and of course, if that information is available both for the public and for Parliament to scrutinize and perhaps even take a decision on, to me, that is a logical approach. I have heard it mentioned, for instance, that the Scottish Government could have, you know, offices in almost every EU member state. I do not believe that is feasible, given the resources of the Scottish Government and given Scotland's constitutional position. So, yes, purposeful expansion, but in a way that is, you know, clearly evidenced to demonstrate the value of why the Scottish Government needs its own representation, as opposed to, for instance, Scottish Development International or, of course, UK diplomatic missions.
Yeah, I think your points are very well made about that, about the need for an evidence-based approach. And previous colleagues' questions you've answered about the Scottish diaspora networks and then the crucial issues of trade and culture and the climate crisis. So there's clearly both a parliamentary and a government priority on those issues. It's seeing how they're actually played out across the EU. In terms of other parts of the UK, there's obviously the Northern Ireland Protocol taken up a lot of energy, but going forward, our committee has been looking at the trade issue going forward and the alignment project. To what extent would those offices and that government connection help in terms of transparency on those issues?
Yes, well, it links back to the purpose of, I suppose, of the individual offices, you know, in terms of the trade and the trade relations view and the Scottish Parliament's scrutiny of that. Of course, the Brussels office, you know, is sort of a logical point of reference in the sense that they are monitoring what happens in the EU institutions and in Brussels more widely. And, you know, that is a core part of the Scottish Government's sort of, you know, monitoring and engagement of what's happening in Brussels, you know, from the outside. That information, that monitoring may be useful to the Parliament in some way, and if that may be possible. And I think that's the main focal point. You know, it's fairly clear at the moment that while, you know, bilateral political relations are a focus of the other offices, they're mainly focused on their own domestic context in the regions. So, you know, for the Paris office, Berlin office, the Dublin office, you know, they're mainly focused on the bilateral relationships between Scotland and those countries, and then where appropriate, nearby countries. So, for instance, Austria, in the case of the Berlin office. They are less focused on substantive engagement on European issues or European Union issues or the specific relationship between the EU and the UK. That is an area that could be developed, but that's not the main focus. So I mentioned from the Parliament's perspective, understanding what's happening in the Brussels office and perhaps the information which is gathering could be useful.
Yeah, that's really useful in terms of thinking about our scrutiny of the government. Just finally, I just wanted to ask you a question, just thinking about the issues of the parliamentary connections. There's obviously the Parliament Partnership Assembly, and as I understand it, the Conference on the Future of Europe isn't finished yet. Have we missed the boat on that, or is the chance to come in towards the end of that officially?
I'm sure that there could well be some option for the Scottish Parliament or wider actors in Scotland to make a kind of contribution to the Conference on the Future of Europe. I wouldn't say that the boat has been missed, but, you know, I imagine it would be something to perhaps, you know, judicious fashion, if you like. And again, that's about saying, you know, as you mentioned, Ms. Boyack, there are clear areas of interest in Scotland and in the EU, be it on climate change or be it on other areas which you've mentioned, and that there are views here in Scotland on what happens in all of Europe. It's not just about the EU. Of course, the Conference on the Future of Europe is an EU conference, but to me, you know, it's worth, you know, articulating that there are shared issues here and shared priorities, and that, you know, despite the reduction in formal access which the Scottish government and indeed the UK government now have as a consequence of Brexit, there are other forums to articulate views. That's not to say that they will become integral parts of EU policy, but that, you know, it's part of sustaining an important conversation and the linkages between Scotland and the EU.
Thanks very much. If I could ask a question to Dr. Zulig, I was thinking to focus in on two of the topics that are clearly of major importance to Scotland, and it was whether post-COP in Glasgow, there are opportunities for us to have practical links that would link activity on climate crisis and economic development between Scottish Government and the EU. Is that something that would be fruitful in terms of putting priorities in for the Scottish Government over the next few months?
I mean, certainly from an EU perspective, this is still top of the agenda. It continues to be a major area of discussion on how we move forward. Of course, there are already policy frameworks which have been put into place to realize some of the goals. So the Green Deal clearly is influencing a lot of the discussion. The Recovery and Resilience Funds are the main mechanism by which the funding is now happening at the European level, and we're starting to see the disbursement of the first funding for that. So there continues to be the possibility of engagement. I would always see this when it comes to policy. There are other functions of having these relations, but when it comes to policy, I think it's always important to see this as a two-way street. It's about, yes, putting the Scottish position into the Brussels debate, engaging with the debate wherever possible, with the limitations which we have already mentioned. But I think also the very important part for Scotland to be aware where the debate is going in Brussels, what kind of future policy priorities might be emerging. And there, one of the challenges is that these debates are no longer separate. You cannot easily say, this is the debate on climate change. We will, for example, have a major debate on what role does climate change play in international trade? What kind of carbon border adjustment mechanism might be necessary? How will that influence the openness of the European Union to international trade? We will have debates around industrial policy, around strategic autonomy, and how far does the European Union have to reshore some activities, protect its supply lines. These will all join into the discussion around climate change. So I think this is a major challenge because engaging with this debate means actually being engaged on that rather broad way of looking at how policy is made. And in addition, we have had a change in recent years that the national dimension is also more and more important within European debates. So it matters what happens in Brussels, but it also matters what happens in Berlin, what happens with the new government there, what are the priorities which are emerging in the presidential election in France. So there is a complexity to this, but I think it is definitely an area where the European Union is very willing to engage, and where there's still a wish by the European Union and the member states to build an international alliance. In that sense, having others on board who share the same values, who share the same direction, is also something which is of political value to the European Union.
That's a very helpful answer. And I suppose just to follow on to the previous questions I asked Mr. Salamon, in terms of our energies as a parliament, there's holding our government to account, and then there's the cross-parliamentary liaison. Your thoughts on the priorities for that in the context of the climate and economic opportunities? Just to follow on from that last answer, what would your advice be for us as a parliament working within the UK with the other devolved parliaments, but also building those links with European, should it be through the representative networks of offices? Should it be direct parliamentary liaison? What would be your recommendations for us as a committee?
From my perspective, the multiplicity of different linkages is always helpful. Also, being able to use different mechanisms. I would say that certainly wherever possible, and this is part of the question internally for the UK. This has nothing to do with the European Union, but part of the question is in how far are the different actors within the UK involved in the formal mechanisms, including, for example, the Parliamentary Assembly. I think it is helpful to use the offices which are there, which in the end are there to serve the Scottish breadth of organizations, including the Parliament. But it is also useful to make direct connections with Parliament. The challenge, of course, is capacity. Doing everything is very challenging. So I would say that probably when it comes to direct parliamentary links, you can't have direct parliamentary links with every member state, with every subnational actor. So it is, again, coming back to the question of what are the areas of priority, and where might there be then an opportunity to work together. So, for example, when we look at the energy question, I think there is certainly a natural cooperation in the North Sea area with some other countries which also have an interest in energy and climate change in that area. So it's very much about looking at the issue and then deciding what is the best way of engaging with that, bearing in mind the limitations and the resource issue.
Thank you. That's very helpful. I'm very conscious we're at the start of a parliamentary term, so maybe these are issues for us to reflect on. Thanks to both the contributors.
Thank you. Dr. Allen?
Thank you, Convener. Mr. Salamone, I think you both referred to Norway and the success that Norway as a non-EU actor has in engaging. It's a great and flexible word, engaging, but engaging with European institutions. Can I ask you what you feel it is that Norway is doing to be so successful? I mean, the obvious answer to that, I suppose, is that it's a long time since Norway sent its diplomatic budget via Stockholm to have someone else represent it. But what is it that Norway is doing that is successful? And is the implication for Scotland that we need to scale up our activities in the future?
Thank you, Dr. Allen. I think there are a number of elements to Norway's sort of approach and, in some cases, success. One is that you mentioned is the budget. The Ministry of Foreign Affairs is well funded. Of course, Norway is a state. It has an embassy of Norway in almost every EU member state. And of course, most of the EU policy engagement is in Brussels. But if you, as Fabio was mentioning, engaging in the politics of the individual member states is crucial too. And Norway is able to do that. And to establish what I call bilateral triangulation. That means that if you want to engage with, for instance, German actors, that you do that in Oslo, that you do that in Berlin, that you do that in Brussels, and you triangulate between them. So Norway has the resources, has the missions, there's that. The other is that Norway articulates a clear strategy. There is a Norwegian multi-annual strategy for engagement with the European Union, and if I remember correctly, annual action plans as well. Which help to focus priorities. Again, yes, you want to connect with what's going on in Brussels and the EU, and in Norway's case, you want to shape that, but you also have your own objectives, your own priorities of what you want to do. And in Norway's case, engaging on shaping the single market, or as Fabian mentioned, on energy or on the Arctic and so on, having that clear choice of objectives. The other is working quite closely in a very unique way with the Nordic EU member states. I mean this in Brussels in particular, the extent to which Norwegian colleagues are able to engage with Swedish and Danish and Finnish colleagues, including the sharing of information, of EU information, which is useful to them, that's very helpful. But at the same time, that is also because Norway spends a lot of time observing what happens in the EU institutions. It can, you know, Norwegian officials can pick up on things which the Nordic EU member states do not. So it's not a question of Sweden, you know, telling Norway things that are happening in the EU and that's it. And the Norwegians are also telling the Swedish things that are happening in the EU that is useful to them. So that degree of Nordic interlinkage, which I say is quite unique, I think that helps a lot. And the other is that the Norwegians are proactive. They're willing to engage. If an opportunity comes up for some sort of meeting in Brussels that is useful and they can attend, they will. They will fly in people from Oslo to augment the personnel that they have. And they see it as an integral part of their, for them, is foreign policy, not being in the EU. So in short, just resources, coordination, engagement, all of it. That doesn't mean you're necessarily going to influence EU policy the way you want to. But if you want to have a hope of doing kind of.
Thank you. And can I ask in that case, Dr. Zulig, the predicament of Scotland, of course, both covers being non-independent and non-EU. But given some of what's been discussed today about the complicated relationship between both the Scottish and UK governments and the UK governments and Europe, what you feel the opportunities are for, if you like, multilateral engagement between the Scottish Government directly and other EU states or sub-states, and whether you feel that, how can I put this, that we shouldn't wait for the UK to come up with a helpful position before we do that engagement?
Yeah, I certainly would see that there's a lot of scope for engagement. I think I would still make the distinction between the formal and the informal. I think when it comes to formal engagement, then the mechanisms which are there, the TCA and all the governance which is attached to that, will be the formal way the European Union interacts with the UK, and that includes also sub-state actors. So there's not going to be a discussion on, for example, trade which between the EU and the UK separate from these mechanisms. But there are many other areas where there can be engagement. I think what is important there, and that's maybe adding a little bit to what Anthony was saying on Norway, I think Norway is also very much aware of its limitations. It knows how far it can go in terms of influencing. It knows that it has to compromise on many areas. And it knows that to be really effective, it needs these alliances. It needs to build something inside the Union to be effective. And on top of that, at least in the past, there are some issues now also domestically, but in the past there was a very strong domestic recognition of the need for Norway to do this. And I think this is also something I would say in terms of the Scottish debate. I think there needs to be a recognition of why this is important, what kind of influence that has. And I would say that certainly the goal of the Scottish government to align as much as possible with the European Union provides that direct link. So I would say, yes, there is a lot of scope for engagement. There's, in my view, also a need for that engagement, but much will depend on how Scotland, and not just the Scottish government, but the wider Scotland, will approach this issue.
Thank you. As you're very aware, Scotland's position is one in a state of flux to some extent, but it was interesting you mentioned alignment there, and I think Mr. Salamone used the word Europeanisation of our political culture. I suppose this is a question for both of you, but do you feel these are two sides of the same coin? Are we talking about roughly the same thing here, or are we talking about different things?
From my perspective, they are certainly connected. So the alignment is a practical expression of Europeanization. But I think this is also a question I would have for the Scottish political system is, what does alignment actually mean? In how far does alignment also mean making difficult choices, the choices where there might then also be divergence with the rest of the UK on certain issues? I mean, of course, this will always depend on the constitutional settlement. It depends on what kind of choices the Scottish government can make. But alignment is a very ambitious commitment. I'm not saying that's not something you should do, but to be truly aligned with what is happening in the European Union is an enormous task. It's an enormous task for member states. It's an enormous task for subnational actors within member states, especially when they have legislative powers which are touched by European policy. So I think if this is really the direction in which Scotland wants to go, it will require quite a lot of focus, quite a lot of investment to make sure that that is a meaningful alignment. And that also means having that two-way discussion with the European Union. Because very often when it comes to alignment, it's not simply about having the text of a law which is then transmitted into the national system. It is about how is that interpreted? How is that then actually realized and implemented? So alignment is a very far-reaching goal. And I think that, yes, if you do it well, it is a certain Europeanization of the debate. Europeanization, in my view, goes further than that. But it is a major task to aim for.
And finally, if I can ask the same point of Mr. Salamone, Europeanization and alignment, how do they connect?
Sure. Thank you, Dr. Allen. Yes, I agree with what Fabian has said. And of course, it'd be rather unusual or perhaps unique for, you know, in the case of a place choosing to align more closely with the EU as part of a third country than as the UK would wish to do as a whole. That is something which, you know, could be new. The alignment aspect, I think, is one part of Europeanization. So just on the alignment specifically, I know it's worth noting the democratic challenges associated with alignment, because then this is the case of any entity which is not part of the European Union. If you choose to be part or align with EU laws or policies or standards, obviously you have no say in those. So, you know, that can still be a democratic choice, but it means that, you know, that there may be some challenges there in the sense that you are not shaping those policies which you are choosing to be part of, or those laws which you are choosing to follow, in a sense. Europeanization for me is much wider, and it links with some of the things Fabian already said about paying attention. So the Scottish politics, Scottish society collectively, specifically, or indeed about any one institution, that there is a great awareness collectively for all of us of what is happening in Brussels, what is happening in core EU member states, how that impacts on what happens in the European Union, how that impacts on what happens for us. The general major debates in the EU, the extent to which Scottish actors understand and are part of, or, you know, acquire European languages and use them, the extent to which practical cooperations are formed between Scottish government, Scottish Parliament, civil society, all of Scotland as a collected team with various actors in the EU. And that generally speaking, including also Scottish media, which gives almost no substantive coverage of European affairs beyond Brexit and independence, that all of that comes together in a way that means that Scotland was much more a part of what is actually happening in the rest of Europe. And I think to a large extent, we are just connected from the substance that goes on in the EU.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I'm looking to see if there's any further questions. I guess the theme of today is, would some power the gift to gears to see ourselves as others see us? And I quote Burns specifically because obviously there's a cultural diplomacy around all of this, and no matter how we feel about the shortbread look of Scotland, you know, this is about much, much more than that. And some of the challenges that I see ahead in terms of our role as a scrutiny in these areas is the fact that we have the PPA coming from the agreement with Europe between Westminster, but we will have no formal role in that as a parliament. So in terms of our role, we are empowered under you know, the Scotland Act to scrutinise our own government's involvement in that, but you know, they will say they have no formal involvement in the TCA at this stage. So that presents a challenge to us in terms of scrutiny, because we have no power to scrutinise the UK government going forward. And while the common frameworks are under development, they're still there. So the uncertainty around the common frameworks and that executive power is to my mind, one of the challenges we have at the moment. How do we do that engagement when at any turn, if that executive power is used in an area of powers coming back to the UK from Europe, even though they're part of the devolved settlement, we still might see the UK taking a different turn. So that's one of the challenges I see, and I would be interested in your comments in those areas. And also, you know, surprisingly, I would consider us very staunchly European in our outlook and our attitude, and having served in this parliament for 10 years, we would say that we have done that, but obviously from what we're hearing today is that much, much more could be done. And I know that we have agreed to, the Scottish Government's committed to Erasmus, but you know, are our institutions seen as key partners going forward in Europe, still in Horizon, our universities in terms of Horizon research? If I look at the economic priorities of the Scottish Government in terms of space technology or life sciences, are we recognised as being able to contribute in those areas, particularly, you know, a lot of investment as well going into fintech in Edinburgh? So where do you see as these key strategic areas for Scotland? Is there any recognition of these developments in Europe at the moment? And that's probably enough to ask at the moment. So I'll go to Mr. Salamone first and then back to Fabian. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. So I very much appreciate the sort of the scrutiny dilemma, if you like, which you have outlined for your committee and the Scottish Parliament. Yes, it is a challenge. I mean, as I outlined in my written evidence, I think it's important, even though it may be unfortunate, to be realistic that the scope that exists for Scottish institutions to influence sort of the EU out with the UK or the UK itself, and that is to say the bilateral institutions of the TCA, is you know, could well be limited. And the best options, so the most promising avenues for scrutiny is through the Scottish Parliament. But I appreciate it. I mean, the Scottish Government, excuse me. But if the Scottish Government isn't as involved, then what do you scrutinise? Yes, I suppose that's part of the evolution of us adjusting to this new kind of relationship with the EU. And as Fabian mentioned earlier, the animosity that exists present between the UK government and the EU, which I suppose we all hope will have a positive resolution. So I'm afraid I don't have any particular answers other than to say that, you know, the whatever engagement the Scottish Government, that's something that I hope that the Parliament can influence. In terms of EU relations broadly, I think it's important to, for at least in terms of my own remarks, to be clear that, you know, there's a lot of good work that goes on in terms of the Scottish Government and engagement with EU actors. A question of not, that nothing is happening or nothing good is happening. It's not that. It's that we're in a post-Brexit reality, and in that context, you know, it's very important to see a strategic vision for, you know, for the years ahead. As I've said on my written evidence, be for 5 years or more. Here are our priorities. Here is what we're going to focus on. Here is how our offices are going to work together as a network. And how we're going to make the kinds of goals we set for ourselves happen in full recognition of the challenges that we face, and they are substantial challenges. In terms of issues like Erasmus or Horizon Plus, even if the UK had agreed to be part of those, you know, there would still be a degree of uncertainty, because as Norway is part of these initiatives, you still, you know, still opts in with every multi-annual financial framework, guarantee in some sense, but it's not a perpetual thing necessarily. In terms of the Scottish Government trying to secure unique access to Erasmus Plus instead of the UK, I do not see that as something which is likely to be successful, to be frank. And I appreciate that could be a disappointment for people, but I imagine that that is the reality of the situation, is if the European Union, you know, is looking for a UK response on Erasmus and the UK government is, does not wish to participate, then there's little scope in between there, unfortunately. So more broadly speaking, I'd say that, yes, you know, the core element of it I want to get across is, you know, the Scottish government having a clear long-term strategy is what's needed at this point.
Dr. Silly?
Yeah, I agree with that. I think the difficulty I would see from an EU perspective, even within the EU, but even more so when you're talking about relations with third countries, it is the government of that country which is the conduit of that relationship. You don't have formal relations with individual parts of that. Now, it is entirely up to that country to then decide how to involve, for example, sub-state actors within that. So what we see, for example, in many federal countries, that the federal regions are very much involved. But it is up to the government to decide in which way that is done, and very often it is based on internal constitutional arrangements. So in that formal sense, I think this will unfortunately mean that there are limitations to what Scotland can achieve because of the relationship the UK is having with the EU at the moment. And at times there have been attempts by the UK government to actively shut down some of the other voices because they have not been seen as being helpful to the negotiation tactic which the UK government has pursued. I think we have to be realistic about what that.
Oh dear. I think, sorry, we lost you for a moment there, Fabian. So. Oh. If you could just, have you concluded your comments? Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, my final point was just to say that I would go back to the distinction between the formal and the informal route. On the formal side, it's very much dominated by what the government wants to do. But on the informal side, there's a lot of scope for cooperation and coordination.
Can I thank you both for your attendance at committee this morning. It's been really helpful. And we will now suspend briefly to swap over to our new panel. Thank you. Welcome back. We now move to our second agenda item, and we are welcome to committee this morning, David McAllister, MEP, Chair of the Foreign Affairs Committee in the European Parliament, and this is a continuation of our inquiry into the Scottish Government's international work. And I would like to invite Mr McAllister to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you. Honourable Convener, Honourable Members, kind regards here from Brussels and the European Parliament. Thank you for inviting me. I'm once again honoured to be a guest of the Scottish Parliament European Affairs Committee. The last time I spoke to Honourable Members of your predecessor Committee on Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Affairs was on the 25th of February this year, just weeks before the final ratification of the EU-UK Trade and Cooperation Agreement. Now we're 7 months into the implementation of this treaty. We certainly face our challenges, but this treaty remains a solid base for EU-UK relations. The withdrawal agreement and the TCA cover a wide array of sectors. The governance framework of these agreements provides tools that ensure a comprehensive and a consistent approach vis-a-vis the United Kingdom. All actions here in the European Union need to be seen together and should be coherent and focused. In the future, we need to seek ways to broaden and to deepen our EU-UK partnership. I believe this would be in the interest of both sides to maintain a close and lasting cooperation given our shared values and interests, especially in an increasingly unstable world. From my point of view, there is potential for foreign and security policy cooperation with the United Kingdom in several areas, such as coordination in multilateral organisations, sanctions, crisis management, capability development, intelligence and development. I do hope that we can exploit this potential in the near future and take benefit of the TCA's broad governance structure and the living character of this agreement, which allows us to build upon a solid base if there is political will on both sides. Let me finish by saying that we as parliamentarians have two key roles when it comes to the implementation of the TCA. We need to ensure close scrutiny of the proper implementation of both the withdrawal agreement and the trade and cooperation agreement, and we need to play a forerunning role in driving forward the debate on future areas of cooperation between the European Union and the United Kingdom. I'll keep it there. Thank you once again for inviting me. It's a great honour, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. If I could maybe open with... Are you okay?
Yes, I'm just asking my assistant to close the shutter because the sun's.
Yeah. So as long as you're hearing us, that's the main thing. So thank you for your introductory statement. We are in a position of having had a very good relationship with Europe as a devolved parliament, as you mentioned in the past. A lot of cooperation between our predecessor committees and Europe, and in terms of while we were aligned with European Union and part of the European Union, that was a kind of more simple situation. But as a committee that scrutinises the government, obviously we are concerned about the level of scrutiny and how we might be able to work with the European Union to ensure transparency around the decisions around the TCA. And I wonder if you have any light to shine on how we might be able to work with the European Committee in order to do that scrutiny.
Okay, thank you. So, I mean, the general question is how can the Scottish Government and how can the Scottish Parliament engage with the European Union and what should it seek to achieve from this engagement? First of all, being of Scottish descent myself, I'm always among the first to welcome close engagement with Scotland and the Scottish institutions. The way Scotland engages with the EU after Brexit will inevitably change also with the change of the relationship between the European Union and the UK. And we all know that the fundamental difference simply is that now the UK is no longer a member of the EU, and it simply doesn't enjoy the same degree of privileges, but also representation in European institutions. And this, of course, also affects the representation of Scottish interests here in Brussels and the way Scotland engages with the EU. I believe that on the one hand, Scotland should pursue its engagement with the EU by pursuing its interests with the UK government, bearing in mind the current constitutional situation of Scotland. This channel remains important and is the formal one. On the other hand, Scotland can pursue a different and more informal engagement with the EU within the limits, of course, of its constitutional position. This includes exchanges like we're having just this morning, as well as informal exchanges on topics of mutual interest, which would be particularly important. Scotland House in Brussels are doing an excellent job. Scotland House is, of course, a useful channel for any kind of engagement with the EU, as well as your representations in some of the member states you have now established. We in the European Parliament, and I can say this on behalf of colleagues from all the different political groups, were keen to hear representatives of civil society and various stakeholders, and of course, politically, democratically elected representatives. So we're happy to have these informal contacts, but also we can reach out at formal events like the one this morning. I think the most important thing is that the Scottish voice is heard in the EU, and therefore, my advice would be use the formal channels you have within the framework of the UK, and on the other hand, use the other channels you have, including the informal ones here in Brussels, to get your message across. Colleagues are very well aware of the fact that the people in your part of the United Kingdom, in Scotland, voted in large numbers to remain in the European Union. That is not forgotten. And we will always try to find flexible, pragmatic solutions to try to get Scotland as close as possible to the European Union.
Thank you very much. I'm going to move to questions from committee members. I'll go to Mr. Ruskell first.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning. Nice that you're in front of the committee this morning, Mr. McAllister. I wanted to ask you about transparency, and in particular in relation to the Parliamentary Partnership Assembly, and I'm wondering sort of what expectations MEPs might have going into that assembly about how open and transparent the workings of that assembly will be. And I'm thinking in particular about, you know, that long-established rights that we have as European citizens to be part of open policymaking, and for the business of policymaking and scrutiny to be open and democratic. So what sort of demands will MEPs be making as to how accessible the workings of that assembly will be, and what will be the implications for European citizens?
Thank you, Mr. Ruskell, for your question. I already said that we parliamentarians play a crucial role in, on the one hand, scrutinising the implementation of the two agreements, but also fostering a debate how we can move forward. I think sessions like today, as well as the good track record of similar sessions with your predecessor committee, show the importance and benefit of our exchanges. I've also attended similar events with the Welsh Assembly's committee, and there's a huge interest in the European Parliament, especially also to reach out to the Northern Irish Assembly, because for many, many reasons at the moment, the political debate here in Brussels is very much focused on the protocol on Ireland and Northern Ireland. Now, when it comes to the Parliamentary Partnership Assembly, I can inform you that just this morning at 10 o'clock we had the constitutive meeting of our European Parliament's delegation for relations with the United Kingdom. We've just voted our president, Nathalie Loiseau, from the Renew Group from France, and two vice chairs, one Irish colleague from the EPP, Sean Kelly, and an SND colleague, a Social Democrat from Bulgaria, second vice chair. And these 35 members in the EP delegation will be the European part of the joint EU-UK Parliamentary Partnership Assembly, which hopefully will soon start its work. The Parliamentary Partnership Assembly is mentioned in the EU-UK Trade and Cooperation Agreement, and we are now keen in organising the first meeting. The new delegation we have here in the European Parliament will closely cooperate with the UK Contact Group, which also gathers representatives from all political groups to scrutinise EU-UK relations and coordinate our position as European Parliament on the matter. Perhaps you can say the differences between the UK Contact Group and the UK delegation, the European Parliament, is that the UK Contact Group is the first point of contact for Vice President Shevchevich before important meetings with Lord Frost, debriefing and briefing members, whereas the parliamentary delegation is more responsible for the contacts with the UK Parliament. Now, we received a lot of recommendations as regards the composition of the Partnership Parliamentary Assembly. Of course, we cannot influence in any way how the British, the UK side, is composed. In the end, the decision was taken that they will be representatives from the House of Commons and the House of Lords. So there will be no members from the devolved nations' parliaments. We, of course, respect this British decision, but I would always welcome you to, as I said, use the different channels of informal cooperation, including the European Friends of Scotland, which is an informal network of MEPs representing different political groups. And I know that Angus Robertson is keeping a close contact also to these members. On the scrutiny, I would say that we in the European Parliament at the moment are very happy with the work of Maroš Šefčovič. He's doing, from our point of view, a very good job, and he's very transparent in his work. We in the UK Contact Group are informed on a regular basis. We will have our next meeting on the 20th December, and we have managed to find such a good cooperation that Vice President Šefčovič can share confidential, relevant documents than being in the newspapers the next day. So we've tested this. So in the moment, I have a group of colleagues around me who are very much interested in getting things done and not so much informing the media in an informal way. So that's what I can tell you about the implementation and the scrutiny here in the European Parliament.
Yeah, thanks very much for sharing that news with us. I mean, obviously, it's very early days, but I suppose what I'm thinking about is practically how, as institutions that are scrutinising this process, or civil society organisations, or even just as European citizens, we're able to engage with this. I mean, will there be full access to papers that are being brought up to the PPA for scrutiny? You know, will there be full disclosure, full transparency? And what might that look like? I mean, what sort of mechanisms are you used to implementing within your own committee, Foreign Affairs Committee? What kind of culture of openness and transparency might we expect for the PPA? And what might that practically look like in terms of sharing of information that's presented to you as elected representatives from both sides, but perhaps might not be available to citizens or those scrutinising the process from afar, as we are here in Holyrood?
Well, we're just at the beginning of setting up this Parliamentary Partnership Assembly. How this will work in practice in the moment, nobody can really tell. But it took a long time to actually establish the PPA. Now, obviously, it took us a long time to agree on size and who's going to be represented. So this has all now been formally set up, but we still don't have a date for our first meeting. So it always takes two to tango, but I'm very sure that we will now see progress also in London to actually move forward. So that's the one point. The second point is... I guess that we might be able to set the standard in Europe, here on the Brussels side, in how we inform parliamentarians. In the moment, we are, as European Parliament, currently receiving all the documents from all committees of the Trade and Cooperation Agreement. So the European Commission is very transparent, and we can't complain about not being informed. Quite to the contrary, I think the way Team Shevchevich is doing this is very impressive. But of course, we don't know what the UK side will be doing. But perhaps if our UK counterparts and colleagues find out, get to know what information we are receiving, they might want to remind the UK government that they would also like to receive the relevant documents.
Okay, thanks.
Ms. Bindle?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Mr. McAllister, for joining us. The previous session of evidence we got talked, as you have, on the formal and informal relationships and contacts that we can have. Clearly, there's a formal relationship for Northern Ireland, and as you've pointed out, the PPA has currently no representation from the devolved parliaments. So I'm wondering what we can learn, perhaps, from relationships that the EU has and the Commission has with other nations. We heard a bit about Norway, and again, it will have a different relationship than Scotland would, but also the Basque countries and Quebec. So just any thoughts that you have as to how the Scottish Parliament and the Scottish Government can engage and build on, as you've said, the perception that Scotland did vote to remain in the EU. Thank you.
Well, as I mentioned, the European Union has close relations with so many third countries in the world. We also have good parliamentary cooperation. I was the rapporteur for Serbia on the last term from 2014 to 2019. I was member of the EU Serbia parliamentary delegation. We met on a regular basis. We had exchanges of views. When Serbian ministers would come to Brussels, interested MPs would be invited for events. We would have lunch events or dinner events. So there are many, many, many ways. But the difference is between a third country and Scotland, that we as a European Parliament cannot establish formal relations with a regional parliament, because we have to respect the constitutional order of the third country we're dealing with. So formal cooperation is not possible, but of course there are many, many possibilities of informal cooperation. And here, I've already mentioned, Scotland House is doing a very good job. They're very active, they're very present. We have the European Friends of Scotland, an informal grouping in the European Parliament. We have colleagues, including myself, who have very close contacts to Scotland, and my door is always open for representatives from the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament, and I'm looking forward to meeting Angus Robertson as soon as COVID conditions allow his travel to Brussels. And I would encourage also you as members of the Scottish Parliament, if hopefully we can get back to normal travelling, get on a plane, get on a train, please come to Brussels. And I'm very sure that you, throughout the political landscape of this Parliament, you will find colleagues who are interested in talking to you and listening to your concerns. And also encourage your government to come on a regular basis. I was a minister president of a German Bundesland from 2010 to 2013 in Niedersachsen, Hanover. And the German minister president is something like the first minister. I traveled to Brussels at least twice a year, because we knew in Hanover that there are so many things going on in Brussels which have a direct impact on Niedersachsen. So, and just like you have Scotland House, I had a representation, or we have a representation here, and they would usually organise a good programme. So please come to Brussels. You're very, very welcome. And also try and invite European officials to Scotland. I was just together with the chairman of the trade, International Trade Committee, and the two of us coordinate the UK contact group. We were just in Northern Ireland for 2 days, and we spoke to representatives of civic society, the business community, the political parties, the Speaker of the Assembly, the members of government, and it was so important for us to be in Belfast on the ground and actually listen to people who are dealing with these issues on a daily basis. And we went back and both said, we want to find the most pragmatic and flexible solutions to facilitate everyday life in Northern Ireland, but within the framework of the protocol. And I'm not in any kind of position to give any advice to the UK government, but on Northern Ireland, I would always ask Lord Frost and his team, please listen carefully to what people in Northern Ireland are saying. Please listen carefully what businesses are saying in Northern Ireland, because they have to live with the consequences of the protocol, not politicians in London.
Thank you for that. And I suppose we also use our contacts with the consuls that are based in Edinburgh and elsewhere in Scotland as well. So it's that kind of two-way conversation as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Can we move to questions from Mr. Golden, please?
Thank you, convener. And thank you, Mr. McAllister, for that welcome, and I'll speak to the convener in due course about perhaps a committee visit to Brussels when restrictions allow, and I'm sure we'd all love to meet you in person. We heard in the earlier panel around Scottish Government's EU engagement and thoughts around two main areas of focus, one around practical cooperation on areas of mutual interest, and secondly around participation in debates on the future of Europe. And I just wondered your thoughts on the Scottish Government's approach around these areas and anything else you would like to add.
Thank you, Mr. Golden, for your question. I can't really add much to what I have just said. I think that the Scottish Government is very present, and Scotland House is doing a great job. Unfortunately, we were not able to find a solution to Scottish participation in the Erasmus Plus programme, because the situation was simply that we cannot allow parts of third countries to join the Erasmus Plus programme, but I've been informed that the Scottish Government has now established a own programme to encourage young EU citizens to study in Scotland. So these are the kind of the ways and means we have. In the end, it will be a political decision in Edinburgh if you want to present the Scottish position through the formal communication channels you have within the constitutional framework of the UK, or if you want to use the informal communication channels that exist. That is a political decision which needs to be taken in Scotland. I guess in the end, a good mixture of both would probably make sense. That's what I can tell you. And then furthermore, there are areas where we would like to see closer cooperation with the United Kingdom, as I already mentioned, foreign policy, security and defence. That is something which is totally lacking in the trade and cooperation agreement. And we here in the European Parliament regret that no agreement has been concluded here. And then, of course, there are other things which have not been finalised yet in our relations. Just think of the wide area of financial services, where we have a memorandum of understanding, but that's not legally binding. We need to move forward here. Then from 2026 onwards, we need a sustainable solution for fisheries. In the moment, we have now the 25% decrease of the TCA, of the TACs until 2026. So this TCA, I consider it being a living agreement. It will need to be adopted to certain realities in the next couple of years. And a final point, I'm receiving a lot of letters in the moment why things are not moving forward on certain topics, including Horizon. I think here there's a simple point to consider. As long as we haven't found a sustainable solution for all the issues around the protocol in Ireland and Northern Ireland, there's not much appetite in Brussels to move forward on other things. So everything is interlinked. And I welcome that in the last 2-3 weeks, my understanding is that Team Šefčovič and Team Lord Frost are really sitting down and trying to work on practical solutions. We haven't set a deadline. We don't want to have drama just before Christmas, but we all know that we can't go on and on and on with the Northern Ireland related issues. So let's try and find a solution for Northern Ireland before the election campaign in Northern Ireland starts, because we don't want this to be politicised, and certainly we as a European Union don't want to be get dragged into domestic politics in Northern Ireland. We will have a meeting with Maroš Šefčovič and the UK contact group on the 20th of December, where we will get the next update of where we are. And once the Northern Ireland related issues are solved, then we can also move forward, I believe, on other important political questions, including all the questions around Horizon, which is, of course, also of huge importance for Scottish universities.
Thank you, Mr. McAllister. Given your experience of devolved assemblies, I wondered just really on two fronts. Firstly, what role the Scottish Parliament could have in scrutinising the Scottish Government's engagement with Europe, and also potentially the role of parliamentarians and local councillors having direct engagement with the European Union and other representatives from across Europe. So, for example, even though Scotland and the UK are no longer part of Europe, we're still invited to observe the Committee of the Regions, for example, and just wonder your thoughts on perhaps how further integration might be able to be aided in that respect.
Well, how you scrutinise the work of the Scottish Government is, of course, up to yourself. I can't judge this, and I can't give you any advice, but the few times I've been to the Scottish Parliament, I think it's always extremely interesting following the plenary debates and the committee work, and that is your job. And a democracy, parliamentary democracy in Scotland is functioning. I have experienced both sides in my political career. I was an opposition Member of Parliament Anita Saxon, then we won the elections, and first I was a majority leader and then Minister President, and I finished my career, Anita Saxon, being back in the opposition. And I can tell you that it's wonderful to be in the opposition, but it's even nicer to be in government. So I wish you all a good success. But that is the nice thing about democracy, that governments actually change. And I'm saying this as a German citizen. You probably followed all on Scottish TV yesterday that we have a new chancellor now, and my political family, the CDU, after 16 years of power in Berlin, will have to learn what it means to be in the opposition and to scrutinise, thoroughly scrutinise the work of the German government. But back to what can the Scottish Parliament do? Well, on the one hand, I think events like today make sense. Invite on a regular basis representatives from the different EU institutions to also speak in front of your committee. Reach out in informal ways to your European counterparts. And when it comes to the engagement of UK representatives in European institutions, well, one consequence of Brexit is that we no longer have British representation in the European Parliament, in the Council, all these other institutions. And that is very unfortunate that the British voice is no longer heard in so many institutions here in Brussels and in Strasbourg. We're now going to build a bridge between the European Parliament and the UK Parliament. The Parliamentary Partnership Assembly. If other EU institutions like the Council of Regions or the Committee of Regions or others will establish similar formal or informal contacts, I can't tell you. But we in the European Parliament have now done our job. We have established the EU-UK Parliamentary Partnership Assembly.
Thank you, Mr. McAllister. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. If I could ask a brief question, Mr. McAllister, in terms of you mentioned the interparliamentary work that's happening, and we have been working with our devolved counterparts and in the devolved legislatures, and we have asked for observer status within the arrangements for the PPA in Westminster. That's something supported by the House of Lords Committee. Is that something you would have a view on? Would you support that approach going forward?
Well, as I mentioned, we have to respect the constitutional order of the United Kingdom, and it's up to the UK side to decide whether representatives of the devolved parliaments can be sitting around the table or not. I have, let's be diplomatic here. I have raised this issue with some of my UK counterparts, and I always received the answer that this will be decided in the UK, and I'll just keep it there.
Thank you. I'll move to questions from Ms. Boyack.
Thanks very much, Convener. It's really good to have you in this meeting with us this morning. Your comments on democracy are well made, and in a sense, we have spent quite a few weeks getting evidence about how we scrutinise the keeping pace legislation. So to have the parliamentary connection, I think, for us is really important. And your observations about subnational state governments are actually quite important for us, because you're still our nearest neighbours, and what we want is effective links plus the accountability. So I suppose for us, the priorities are about how we maintain those ongoing relationships and that interparliamentary liaison work, I think, is something that's important for us within the UK, but of course across Europe as well. I was going to ask, what are the opportunities for us if we think about top priorities post-COP26, shared climate agenda challenges, you've got the climate challenge that people in Germany and Belgium experienced this summer, you know, the climate crisis, what relationships do we need to foster and how that links into our trade relations. What is our best approach for keeping pace with colleagues in Europe, both at the European level in terms of the European Parliament, but also thinking about devolved states and that regional government agenda, which is very important for us.
Well, if you're interested in finding out what we're doing at EU level, I would suggest that you reach out to representatives of the Commission. The European Green Deal is probably the biggest project for the Commission led by President Ursula von der Leyen in this term. The Commission has now presented the so-called Fit for 55 package, which is a huge legislative proposal, which the European Parliament and the Council will now have to agree on. I believe that these debates will at least take 1.5, perhaps even 2 years. So what you might be interested in is, as soon as travel conditions are there, come to Brussels, speak to people in the European Commission and get a presentation. What is the European Green Deal and what is especially this Fit for 55 legislative package? Climate change is a huge task for all of us, all over the world and all over Europe. What you might also be interested in is, because, I mean, I can only say this from a German point of view, that the German Bundesländer in many ways have similar competences like you do in the Scottish Parliament. So you might be interested in, for instance, reaching out. I think you have a good partnership with Baden-Württemberg in Germany to reach out to Baden-Württemberg. What does active climate change policy mean for a regional government, for a regional parliament in Germany? I think you could perhaps learn a lot here, but also we in Germany can, of course, learn what this means for us, what you're doing in Scotland, and I know that it's one of the top priorities of the Scottish government in this term. So that's what I would do. Ben, I wanted to say, as a European citizen, congratulations to Glasgow for being such a good host of the COP26. Those representatives I spoke to who are in Glasgow were amazed how friendly the Glaswegians were, despite their city being invaded by thousands of international guests. I hope that all participants behaved. And when it comes to our EU-UK relations we are talking about, I just wanted to underline that in the Trade and Cooperation Agreement and in the Political Declaration in particular, there are level playing field provisions, and they refer to six fields: competition, subsidy control, state aid, state-owned enterprises, and designated monopolies, taxation, labour and social standards, and environment and climate. So climate also plays an important role in the implementation of the Trade and Cooperation Agreement and also our parliamentary scrutiny.
Thanks. I think that's useful feedback both for our Net Zero Committee and for our Economy Committee. I think our challenge is keeping the overall relations and the scrutiny of overall relations between Scotland and the EU post-Brexit. Your comments earlier about inter-parliamentary liaison have been very useful, particularly in response to your diplomatic answer to the convener. I think that's something we want to keep pursuing. But the other point is the trade keeping pace agenda, the challenge of us, to what extent do our Scottish offices in Brussels and other parts of the EU, to what extent can we make better use of them in terms of keeping in touch with the developments that you see taking place in the EU? The conference on the future of Europe was mentioned earlier. Are there lessons from that project that would be useful for us to be kept aligned with so that we can anticipate what's happening next in the EU and at least have the bilateral relationships so that we're we can see what's coming next and potentially think about where it suits us to align in Scotland and the rest of the UK?
Well, first of all, I guess that Scotland House is closely following what we're doing, what we're discussing in the Commission and the Council and the European Parliament, and that Scotland House will be providing the Scottish Government with all the relevant information. And I mean, Scotland House knows that I'm always very impressed how they work here. They're a small team, but they're a very effective team, and they're very visible and very present. And they reach out, and I also understand that Scotland House is working on a network of people, including myself, who have relations with Scotland, who are dedicated to bringing Scotland or the whole European, the whole United Kingdom as close as possible to the European Union. On the Conference of the Future of Europe, I am not a member of the Conference of the Future of Europe. I understand that the meetings are public, so they can be, you can follow them web stream. What the conference in the end will bring, it's too early really to tell yet. The conference is gathering input in the moment. It would be premature to already say what conclusions they will make, but we certainly need to steer the European Union in a more geopolitical context. You might have followed that President Ursula von der Leyen has announced that she's leading a geopolitical commission. And I think one of the main questions which is already being debated in the Conference on the Future of Europe is how can we strengthen the EU's position at a global level? Because what we are seeing is when it comes to trade, we are a superpower. When it comes to trade, we are at eye level with any other power in the world, including the United States and China. But when it comes to foreign affairs, and especially defence and security, the European Union is not a global player. Or as I sometimes say, we are the global payer, but we're not a global player. And we definitely need to better coordinate our common foreign and security policy in Brussels, and we definitely need to become more effective, not only strategically, but also the way we have our decision-making processes. We've probably made more progress on security and defence in the last 5 years than in 55 years before, and this unfortunately also has to do with Brexit, because as long as our British friends were sitting around the table, we couldn't make any progress at all on security and defence cooperation. And after 2016, from the last years the UK was still in the EU, they weren't happy with these debates, but they said they would no longer veto things when we tried to move forward. But I also want to tell our British friends, if we're now discussing a closer European cooperation on security and defence, and this will be a priority of the French presidency of the Council in the first half of 2022, I would always underline this is not about doing anything in competition with NATO or against NATO or duplication of NATO capabilities. It's about strengthening the European pillar within the established framework of NATO. And we, of course, know that the UK remains for us a very important and loyal NATO ally. So if you follow the debates here in Brussels and in Paris in the next few months about closer cooperation on security and defence, it's not against NATO. It's trying to strengthen the European pillar within the NATO framework. A final point, I'm not sure if there's already an English translation of the new coalition agreement of the German government. For the first time, we have a three-party coalition in Germany. Germans love very detailed coalition agreements. And that's something I know about a lot of British counterparts observe with great interest. It might be worth reading the coalition treaty on pages 130 plus, where the new SPD Liberal Green government in Germany also describes the German approach towards Europe. And when it comes to the conference of the conference on the future of Europe, for instance, the new government in Berlin expects that the conference on the future of Europe will lead to a, as we Germans call it, Verfassungskonvent. It might be so a new convention how to reform the existing treaties of the European Union. I'm not sure that all 27 member states are discussing this from the same angle in the moment, but at least here you can see an approach in Berlin which will be, I guess, echoed in Paris, in Luxembourg, in Belgium, and in a few other countries. That's what I can tell you.
Thanks very much. I'm certainly following the recent agreement in Germany with great interest. Thanks for that answer to that question.
Thank you, Dr. Allen.
Thank you, Convener, and welcome, Mr. McAllister. It's always nice to have such a friendly and very diplomatic face to deal with in terms of our relationship with the European Parliament. You are diplomatic, and you have said a number of times that you quite rightly, you've said that you have to respect the constitutional order in the UK. Of course, I don't have to do that, so I'll ask a question as diplomatically as I can, which is that you've talked about the fact that we can use channels through the UK to communicate with the EU, and of course you've alluded gently to the fact that the relationship has not been simple over the last few years between the UK and the EU. Has it been conveyed, or is it something that's widely appreciated, that the sense of frustration that the Scottish Government and many actors in Scotland have, that for reasons that are not your fault, we can't exercise really any formal channels of parliamentary communication and have to rely on the informal ones?
Well, life's too short to be dragged into domestic British politics. I have so much dealing with European politics here at EU level and national politics in Germany that I simply am a very interested observer of British politics, and I know so many politicians from all the different political parties in the UK, but I just try to remain as diplomatic and neutral as possible. How you organise things in the UK, that's up to you. I can only give you the advice, use the formal channels, but also you're welcome to use all the informal channels. And I want to tell all members of this great committee, whenever you're in Brussels, and regardless of your political affiliation, you're always welcome to come to my office. I have a fantastic view here on the 15th floor of the Spinelli building, and my team serves one of the best coffees you can get in Brussels. I'm always happy to listen to your points and all the issues, and I'm probably one of the few German politicians who actually follow Scottish politics closely and sometimes even listen to Good Morning Scotland on the internet in the morning. That's all I can really tell you. And I think I've been clear that there are so many informal channels you can use. And here there are people across the political parties in Brussels who very well know exactly that the public opinion in Scotland in 2016 was slightly different than in other parts of the UK. And by the way, we also missed the six Scottish MEPs, as we miss most of our British colleagues. It's just so sad that the British voice is no longer heard in these institutions. And that's why, if we can't hear them in the institutions, we need to invite people from the third country, UK, to our institutions so you can get your messages across.
That's a very diplomatic and very kind answer, so we will take you up on your invitation individually and hopefully at some stage when it's possible collectively too. I wonder if I could ask, perhaps more diplomatically in that case, if I could ask a little bit about, from a German point of view, the Länder and obviously your experience in Lower Saxony, what kind of role the Länder create for themselves in representing themselves to Brussels, and whether that varies from land to land?
All 16 German Bundesländer have representations here in Brussels. Of course, the bigger Länder have more staff here than the smaller ones. I mean, the German Länder are very different in size. You have North Rhine-Westphalia with nearly 20 million people, the economic powerhouse of Germany. And on the other hand, you have the tiny little Bundesland of the city of Bremen, and the city of Bremerhaven. Together, they have about 600,000 people. But all 16 Länder have representations. Very active ones are North Rhine-Westphalia, Baden-Württemberg, Hessen, and Niedersachsen. So you might at some stage might want to have a look at, let's say, Baden-Württemberg, which is probably the Bundesland you have the closest contacts to. Go to see the Baden-Württemberg representation or the Niedersachsen or the Hessen representation. What do they do? How are they staffed? What kind of events do they organize? And how do they report back to their regional capitals? The most active and the most visible German representation on the Länder side is, of course, Bavaria, which has this fantastic location directly next to the European Parliament, the castle, where a lot of people often ask me, is that the house where the Commission President lives? I said, no, it's the representation. I said, oh, it's for German representation. Oh, no, it's the Bavarian representation. So as in many things in Germany, Bavaria is usually the gold standard. But of course, Bavaria is an extremely wealthy German Bundesland, and they can afford more things than other Bundesländer. So that's the one thing. The second thing is, I was a minister president from 2010 to 2013. I went to Brussels usually twice a year. It differs if you look at the 16 Bundesländer, but usually it makes absolute sense that a German minister president comes at least once or twice a year to Brussels. We have some Bundesländer who have even organized cabinet meetings in Brussels. I remember two or three years ago, the Bavarians were here with the whole government. And then on a regular basis, we also have committees coming from the Länder parliaments to Brussels. Of course, I'm only aware when the Niedersachsen come, but I would say in a five-year term of the Niedersachsen parliament, every committee of the Niedersachsen parliament will come to Brussels at least once during the five-year term. Because I mean, there are so many things which are of huge importance here in Brussels for us in Niedersachsen, Volkswagen, climate change, agriculture, education, research. And I always encourage my colleagues in Hanover from our regional parliament, come to Brussels. I have never met anyone who said that I was less informed going back to Hanover. So I know sometimes Brussels appears to be very complicated, and the procedures are sometimes different than in our own countries. But I can only encourage you, as MSPs, come to Brussels, and you will be received well by the people in the Council, in the Parliament, and I guess also in the Commission.
Thank you for that invitation, and thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Mr. McAllister, thank you very much for your attendance at committee this morning. Your points about visits and that personal contact are well made. It may interest you to know, in the previous session of the Parliament, as Convener of the Education Skills Committee, I was able to visit Hanover and see the STEM Expo there that's put on for the pupils from everywhere in Lower Saxony to come to Hanover for that conference that they have every 2 years. And it was an incredible experience, and I was very welcomed by your colleagues in Hanover. So we'll take from that some possibilities going forward. And thank you. I'm sure you will see more of us over the coming months and years. But thank you very much for your attendance this morning.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, colleagues. And good luck for your political work of the fantastic country of Scotland.
Now going to Parliament, and that's us for the day. Thank you very much.